three brave amigos are we. Brother to brother.
Welcome back to The Price of Business. I am your host, Kevin Price. This is already the final segment of today's program. I'm delighted to be with the three AM egos. Sibian Kramer?
Who?
Kramer, whatever your name is. That guy who continuously gets invited to leave every day, but somehow doesn't. And he is the producer of this program.
Extraordinaire.
And also, he is a host of a program over there on our sister station, KKHT. What time are you on over there?
10 to 3, buddy. I should be there very shortly.
Yeah. Whenever I get lonely and miss you, I turn on 100.7.
100.7, the word, KKHT.
And I say, I know that guy's voice. And it's amazing how quickly I recover and am able to change the channel.
Really absolutely. Yeah, I'm surprised you haven't swerved off the road into a ditch.
And then there's Dan Shedd. He's our intern extraordinaire, whom we have asked to go out and find stories, and occasionally he does, and he did today.
But he keeps coming back. That's the problem.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Dan, what do you got for us today?
Today I have that reading on a screen before bed might be actually killing you.
What?
Well, you know, I could see where it could hurt your back. You know, if you're laying on a screen, that would, you know, be uncomfortable. But kill you? Really? Oh, you mean actually the screen itself?
Are the neutrinos? Are the neutrinos getting funky with your brain cells or something?
According to a study released by the Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts,
go no further.
reading from an iPad before bed will not only make it harder to fall asleep, but it will also affect how alert and sleepy you are the next day.
Yeah, you know that was going to come. Yeah, I agree with that. In fact, I've gotten kind of strange where, like, you know, middle of the night, you have to go hit the restroom. I used to have the light on in the restroom, you know, to get to it. Now I do it the room behind the restroom, you know, in the hallway. So I still have the light to get in there, and I don't even want the light on in there, man. I just want to. I want to keep those pupils as broad as possible, because my theory is, you get those pupils small, you're waking up. You're you know, and it's hard enough to go to sleep at 53. Than it used to be.
I can't imagine what your bathroom must smell like.
It's incredible, man. I'm very calculating about this thing. There's enough light to not do damage, but you know, this is one of those things like Dizzy Dean, the great pitcher, you know, the old school pitcher. You know, it's one of those things where he said, I can't tell you how many times the second that ball left my hand, I wanted to bring it back because I knew it just wasn't going to fly right. The second that rolled off my tongue is like, man, why do you put a kick me sign on your own derriere, Kevin? But anyway, seriously, I'm totally into this concept. I have to shut down my computer about 2 hours before I go to bed just to try to get that energy down to a lower level.
That's because your computer's really that slow.
No. Although it can be, it has been in the past.
It's in the shop right now, isn't it?
Yeah, but not for. Yeah, it's actually it's a hard drive, not a hard drive. It is a motherboard problem, not a fatherboard. A motherboard.
That's because your wife threw it at you. So anyway, Dan. So this study says that what specifically happens?
Oh, you already did that.
The study actually says that. Reading on screens alerts sleeplessness and alertness and suppresses melatonin levels.
Okay, that's what I was getting at. So it affects the melatonin reuptake.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Makes sense to me, man. You know, your brain's being told it's nowhere near time to hit the hay, and so we're just going to keep blowing and going.
Now, you know,
that means that you don't ever get into that. What's that level
REM
of sleep?
REM sleep.
You don't ever get to that.
Rapid eye movement, baby.
Yeah, you don't ever get to that because your brain is still thinking at any moment you're going to get back on that screen and all that kind of stuff.
Strangely, the same thing happens when I listen to REM.
Ah, put him bump. You gotta get. You know, you're the guy with the buttons over there. You need to be doing that.
Oh
that,
no,
that
I had it. I just didn't think.
There you go. Thank you.
Yeah. So, Dan, what do they suggest instead? Instead of using doesn't this kill the whole idea of the Kindle Paperwhite though?
Which is supposed to be read before you go to bed.
Yeah.
Oh, that should be their motto.
Read before bed?
Yeah. Meant to be read before you go to bed.
Hmm. But, I mean, the,
you
see,
you should read it with sunglasses on.
I wear my sunglasses at night so I can
see. Oh, yeah. My.
Yeah, yeah. Child of the
radio is reaching another low. 70s. Radio reaches another low.
So Dan, what do they suggest instead? What about reading a handheld, like a real paperback?
What?
They do actually recommend that, and they actually recommend also that if you have to absolutely be on your computer before going to bed, that you should. Try getting a filter that blocks the blue light coming from your computer screen and your cell phone. They have several apps out there that are for Android and iPhones, or what I've used now on my laptop actually
is an IBM Pet.
What?
An IBM Pet. You know, the old huge computer that had like the green 15-inch, you know, it was just like DOS, and it had like green letters, text. That's all it had. It was a black screen with green text. That's what you should
use. That green won't have that disruptive
effect.
Just
bring IBM Pet back, baby.
Yeah.
Put your pet in bed with you.
Exactly.
Come on. I've marketed it right there.
Yeah, I hope you get a check.
Bring your pet to bed with you.
Yeah, according to this article, Chang said, Chang, I guess, is a doctor who oversaw the study.
He said, the janitor.
He said that sleep deficiency, not getting enough sleep or obtaining poor quality sleep, has been linked to other health problems such as obesity, diabetes, and cardiovascular disease.
Well.
And chronic suppression of melatonin has also been associated with increased risks of certain cancers.
Yeah.
And by the way, Chang is a she and not a he.
Of course. It was at the Women's Hospital. Anyway, Dan, save us, buddy. What else you got?
Yeah. Ain't got
I'm
nothing.
Sorry. They also they have a program on that you can use on your computer called Flux, and it actually changes your light on your screen so that instead of acting like, oh, it's sunlight, it actually suppresses the screen to make it look like... you know, what your eyes are supposed to look at, you know, at night.
Which is nothing.
Yeah.
Because it's night and it's dark, and anything man-made is going to detract from the just incredible darkness that we should be enrobing ourselves in at night, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
exactly.
We're supposed to be in a really dark room to get a good amount of sleep. In fact, they've had studies. Have you noticed that pretty much you walk into a room and now there are little tiny LEDs all over the room, green, blue, red, you name it, orange. Everything's got an LED light now.
Everything.
And so, you know, your bedroom is filled with everything from your phone, your tablet, even the LED on the smoke detector, your clock. There's LEDs everywhere. They've done studies that show that those really are not good for you. So here's my thought. Why not start creating stuff that doesn't have LEDs on it to let you know it's on? I mean, I know my light is on because the light is on. I don't need an LED to tell me the light is in the off position.
The light's on. Yeah. 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 All right. This is pretty weak, but thanks for bringing it to us anyway. Appreciate it, man.
You're welcome.
Yep. That's Dan Shedd, intern extraordinaire. What do you got? Anything
else?
You
were harsh. That was so harsh. I mean, I know Kevin's New Year's resolution is supposed to be nicer, and it.
Where did you hear that lie? That's a lie.
We're not there yet because you're still like a day away from it.
Yeah.
Could you at least start ramping up towards it?
No. My New Year's resolution is to stop being such a softy.
Oh boy, am I in trouble?
Oh yeah, 2015. That's gonna be a brutal
long year.
No, actually, Dan, I think this is a morality tale for anyone out there thinking about using their device at night. And so, user beware. Actually,
that's
it was very useful.
Have you
I don't see the humor though. I guess that's what I struggled with. Did you see humor in this? Is it funny for people to die? I guess if it's not yourself, there could be some humor to it.
Well, I mean, the whole idea that these things like the Kindle are designed for bedtime, and now the study's saying, by the way, don't use that device, then, I mean, is it going to hurt sales?
So it seems to me that if you're a smart entrepreneur, that you would instantly be building it with that thing that he talked about, that filter automatically would be on that, and marketing it as the one for bed.
Well,
this is the one for bed.
Just leave it to China. Alibaba will answer.
Alibaba will answer. Wait a minute. That doesn't sound Chinese at all, dude.
I know. It's so weird.
Man, even that is made in China?
Even Arabian names are made in China today. All right. I know you had something else for us, Dan. Come on. Spit it out. What do you got?
Well, it is the holiday season, and a Texas town named Pantango is trying to have a toy drive called, it's called the Cops for Kids program, where officers will give a flyer out for people who they pull over, and they are basically asking for toys instead of paying for a fine. So you get pulled over, instead of having to pay a fine for whatever you got pulled over for, they're asking for toy donations, which is a great cause, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Where's this at? Is this in the North Pole?
No.
No. Where's this at?
This is Pantango, Texas, which is outside of Dallas.
Okay. So
everything is outside of Dallas.
Everything is outside of Dallas. That's right. So forever, you'll associate the purchase of Christmas presents with speeding tickets and fines. I don't know. I'm not sure if this is a good thing or not. Sigmund, what do you think?
Well, here's my thought. Usually a speeding ticket's probably like, what, $150, $200? Are they expecting people to buy $150 or $200 worth of toys?
Ooh, boy.
Or can you just, like, go get a cheap little, you know, $5 China-made toy? And then you're good to go.
According to the article which I found on Fox News, they just give the people that they pull over a flyer, and they say that they're waving a citation in hopes that you will drop off a unwrapped toy to the police department.
So then they're not actually coming after the people that don't participate, are they?
No.
I mean, you're not going to have like a policeman dressed up like Santa Claus with handcuffs coming out. Okay. Then I got no problem with that. I think it's great.
I'm thinking that these are all people that they probably would have warned. You know what I'm saying? If they were going 45 miles per hour in a school zone, I don't think they're going to have a blind eye to that. If they were going 85, on a freeway, I think it's probably marginal cases.
It'd be hilarious. It's like some dudes just robbed a bank,
and they're you gotta use that money.
And they were chasing them down, but they didn't know that they had just robbed a bank. And so, the guys were kind of speeding, so they got pulled over. And the cops like, "Hey, you were going over the speed limit, right? Well, here's a flyer." The guy's like, "I won the lottery. I won life's lottery. I'm getting out of a ticket," and they didn't recognize that I just robbed a bank.
Yeah.
That would be fantastic.
That would be fantastic. What's fantastic about that story?
Because it's just so ridiculous.
It is ridiculous. What is it about ridiculousness and random that has captured the imagination of an entire generation?
Yeah.
And I say that, my kids use that expression random constantly.
So random.
That's hilarious. If it's random, it's hilarious. And I try to get them to watch Monty Python, which is like the most random thing in the entire world, and they don't get it. Why? What is it? What's with that?
Because apparently random has also devolved to lowest common denominator. And even though Monty Python was random, it still had, you had to use your brain to laugh at it,
it was more thoughtful.
Random. Yes.
What about you? Do you like Monty Python, Dan?
Yes, I've seen a little bit of it. I think it is funny.
Mm-hmm. Is it random?
I think it's random.
Mm-hmm.
But that's just mine.
Well, you're a millennial, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So, what is it about randomness that resonates with millennials? I never heard that word used before, except for, in a context of it something just being random, but it became a synonym for humor or funny at some point.
Well, just like cool.
What's up with that?
Well, think about cool. The word cool, it doesn't necessarily mean it's chilly outside.
That's true. Or bad. Bad doesn't even mean bad.
Bad has gotten to the point.
I'm bad.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah, and so help us out, though, with randomness and millennials.
Well, I think when something's random, according to us millennials, I think, you know, it's just, you know, out of the blue.
Out of left field.
Exactly. Like, you know, something completely, you know, we didn't see coming, you know, happens, and it's just like, wow.
So it's surprising. Okay. So random means a surprising.
Surprising and odd, you know, oddball stuff, you know?
Yep. It says that about half of all those who got a warning got one of these flyers actually provided a gift. That's pretty amazing.
That sucks.
Only half?
Yes.
Is that your thought?
Yeah, I'm negative. I'm not an optimist. I
think it was half full.
No, I think it was half empty.
Man, what do you think?
When it comes
half
to
full
kids,
or half empty, what do you think? That would be you, Dan.
Okay, sorry. I'm more on the positive side.
Yeah, so you got two half fools and only one half empty, and then
so you're happy that 50% of the people who were basically got off scot free actually took advantage of the situation and did the right thing.
Yeah, I'm pretty happy with that too.
Okay,
considering how screwed up our culture is, I'm pretty happy with that too. By the way, make sure you look up online, Dan, the article on this on today.com, because Today actually did a story. There's video footage there. That'd be cool for the listener to see what they can see right now of the magic of Dan Shedd. Right now.
Wow.
They'll be able to see it. That's how good he is.
That's amazing.
All right, Dan Shedd, thanks so much. We haven't seen much of you lately because you've become a major superstar and unavailable, and we've been really busy with real programming, but we're delighted we were able to spend some time with you, man.
I always enjoy it, guys. And
all right, so that's it for us today. And I give this a good ranking. It's warm and fuzzy, and I could use some warm and fuzzy.
You got to have the warm and fuzzy this time of year.
So good job, dear Dan.
All right, thanks.
When we come back tomorrow, much more for you. I do want to remind you, best content here is over there at usdailyreview.com. Have a great day. Spending it right here.